Home Sweet Home, CRT Transmissions. All right, we're at the shop, and like I told you earlier, this video is going to be nothing on but 727 pumps, the pump stators, and the different years and everything of the pumps, the interchangeability, how to identify them without looking up in a book. This will be a great reference video for the do-it-yourselfer at home, your average Mopar guy that's building transmissions. So let's get into it. I'm going to move the camera so we can get a closer view of these parts and not my ugly mouth. All right, the first thing I want to show you guys, there's basically, we're going to start on pump covers. These are pump covers. There's 2 years of pump covers that go with 5 different years of 727s. And I'm going to show the difference between the two. Let's start with the first one. This pump cover is easily identified. It has this little steel cover on it that covers the vent right here. I want to tilt that camera up just a little bit. Which is the 1962 to 1970 pump, at least the cover is concerned, is that year. It's easily identified by the steel plate that's held on by the two pump bolts. And what it does is it covers the vent. So when you're looking, and like if you go to a boneyard or you're looking through your inventory and you want to pick out a particular year, we all know push buttons have a cable case, so that's 62 to 65. And then from 66 to 70, they went to conventional linkage. But the pump covers are the same from 1962 to 1970. Then in 1971, Chrysler took the vent and made it a plastic one on the inside, right here. So there's no steel plate covering the vent. And so again, when you're looking for cores, if you want to do a quick identify, you can look at the pumps and like, oh, I know for a fact this one's 71 and up, and I know for a fact this one's 66 to 70, unless it's a push button, then it's a 62 to 65. So that is the easiest way to take a look, just by looking at the pump, of approximate what year your transmission is. And for the purposes, you know, everybody likes the 71 and up because that's the year that the stator has the wide land bushing, so you can run billet drums. But in any case, this is how you tell the difference. So the 62 to 70 pump also had this little tin cover on the inside. And it's, I don't have the stators of the pump gears in here, okay? I'm just showing you where this goes. And this is the vent here. On the inside, this is the outside. So Chrysler put a little steel plate here to reflect the fluid from going out the vent, and they put this one here. So as far as the differences between the 62 to 70 pump and the 71 and pump, 71 and up pump, the only differences is the vent. So that means these pumps are interchangeable. So if you have an early tranny and you want to run a later pump cover, you can. I'm going to show you the differences in the pump stators. Those you have to know pretty good. They take the same front seal, they take the same pump bushing, they take the same pump O-ring. And actually, Chrysler took this pump O-ring, seal, and bushing and used it all the way up to 2007 on their 46, 47, 48 REs. So this design has been around from since 62 to 2007 or 6. I don't remember what the last year was for the 47 or 48 RE. But it's been around a long time. As far as servicing these, when you do a rebuild, you want to make sure that the where the bore is that the pump gear goes, the inner and outer pump gear, you want to make sure it's more of a visual thing. You want to make sure that there's no wear marks in there, nothing your nail can get attached to, and you just want to make sure it's good. I really have over an abundance of these pump covers. Because yeah, they do go bad, but for the most part, it's a good part that wears little. You know, even with the tons of miles that some of these transmissions could have on them, they wear pretty good. The pump gears between the two are also the same, so you can interchange the inner and outer pump gear to an early to a late. And also, the 71 and up is also the same if it's lockup. So there's no differences. Chrysler didn't make any changes to this pump cover when they went to a lockup style torque converter. All that's done in the input shaft and stator, which I'm going to get into. They did change the pump gear size when they went to the 518, which is also later on. They renamed it when they updated it to a 46 RE. So the pump gears sizes are different. And how many how many outer rounded teeth are on there changed too. So you can't interchange this with the 46 RE or the 518 unless you use the pump gear. Now, as far as servicing these, really the only thing you can do is, the only thing you have to do is put pump bushings in it, and seals and gaskets. And I brought a pump bushing to show you how I do it. And I mean, it's just something I thought I'd give a hand. This is your standard bushing. Your brass bushing, and what I did is I took a regular old snap-on screwdriver, and I flattened it. I wonder if I can get that in there. No, all these are staked. If you look at the bushing, the way Chrysler staked them, what I did is I ground this tool, this old screwdriver, so it makes a factory looking style stake. I'll take a picture of this, a close-up picture, and post it on here so you guys could make one for yourself. We're going to take the bushing driver, and we're simply just going to, I've never done this on my parts counter, but we'll see how it goes. If you guys don't have bushing drivers, your engine guys might, they call them bearing drivers. You could ask a friend for one. These are the real nice set that I got through Snap-on. I've had them since I was a kid. But if you don't want to buy the tool and you guys are doing this at home, simply take your pump bushing and your pump, and I'm sure you can go down to your local transmission shop and it'll take 2 minutes. But if you're a do-it-yourself guy, this is how I do it. So I'm going to show you how. So you just simply will drive the old bushing out like so, and then I flip it up this way, and then instead of using the same bushing driver to install it, I take a larger one and use it, and I'll show you why. Also, before you install this, you got to find where the bushing meets. There's like a jigsaw puzzle right there. And you always want to put that at 3 o'clock, because if you put it at 12 o'clock or 6 o'clock and you go stake it with the tool, you're going to ruin the bushing. So you don't want to stake where the two halves of the bushing go. So I'm just going to place that in there. And then I'm going to use the larger bushing driver. And the reason why I like doing that, we'll get this a little straighter, is because when you go down with the driver, not only is it going to put it in, it's going to make sure that the bushing is not cocked in the bore. It's going to be perfectly centered down. So let's go ahead and drive that in. Okay. Now, the bushing's not in all the way, but the bushing is square in the bore. So it's not in there cocked. So then once I know it's square, I look down there, and a lot of times I'll spin the pump to make sure it is flat, but it is. Take the bushing driver that goes in there, and you go down there so it just goes past the little recessed lip, like so. And then I take the tool that I made and I stake them. And then that way it looks like a Chrysler factory stake. And you do that to each side. And the stake keeps the bushing from walking out and coming in contact with the front seal. And it keeps it in there. It's a Chrysler thing. So then what I do is I have a jig of a torque converter, and before I put the transmission completely together and then put the converter in, I always like to test fit. So I go in there and I go, yeah, see that? Nice. I'll also reuse this tool once the pump is completely assembled to make sure that the gears are free in there too, because sometimes and it also helps it align it. So when you go put the torque converter in, you're not spinning. Once the pump is built and you have the seals and everything in here, I take the pump and I go down here, and then I make sure that the pump gears come in contact with the drive gear or the drive hub on the torque converter, and I just go back and forth and go click, 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 click. You can hear the pump gears touching the torque converter and going side to side on it. So that's something I like to do. So it's really not fussy. That's how I do the pump bushings. So and while I have this here, and this pump bushing being drove in goes for all of them. You can use this for, it don't matter what year it is, that procedure is done exactly the same way. So I want to talk to you about pump gears. Chrysler pump gears can go in either way. When we disassemble pumps here at CRT, I always make sure that it's a matched set. I don't like robbing an inner gear with an outer gear. I leave them as a match set. Even though you can put them in either way, if you can see which way they were in, and some Chrysler pump gears have a sharper edge on one side and a more rounded edge on the other side, I always put the rounded edge flat in the pump. Because when you're putting your torque converter in, that rounded edge is going to help center the pump gear on the torque converter when you are installing the converter into the transmission. So that really helps. As far as inspection on your pump gears, you want to look at the rotors and the tips, and make sure, you know, you're going to see some little wearing, but you don't want to ever get your nail caught in a groove or anything like that. You want to make sure that the flatness, and just you have to inspect everything, the inside, the outside. I have a little piece of a stone with sandpaper on it, and I'll sit there and I'll sand, flat sand the pump gears, flip them over and flat sand them, just to make sure they're true. This is a stock set of Chrysler pump gears, and I want to show you why we offer racing pump gears. If you take a stock set of Chrysler pump gears and put it on any converter, aftermarket Chrysler converter, doesn't matter, you're going to see that there's a lot of slop between acceleration and deacceleration. And what happens is in higher horsepower applications, I would say, you know, 650, 700 and up, or small blocks that rev really fast on the way up and then really fast on the way down. When you're going down the track, the pump gear is being driven on one side of each tooth. And then when you go through the finish line and you lift and the engine starts to deaccelerate, then it goes to the other side. And that's where the pump gears snap. It'll take these two ears off. It is common. It doesn't happen a lot, but it definitely is common. Another time I've seen guys where, let's say they got like a 14-to-1 compression motor, they'll pull it in their garage, or they'll pull their race car into the trailer, they'll shut it off, strap it down, go home, they come out to unload the car to the garage, and then it doesn't move at all. It just quit moving. They're like, I don't understand. The car, I drove it in the trailer. Well, the same scenario happens. When the engine's running, even in neutral or park, it's driving the pump gear one way. And then when you shut it off, the motor sometimes might kick back, and it'll break the pump, get the lugs of the pump gear. Sure, if you get a new converter, that when you before you do your pump, you want, if you're using stock pump gears, you want to make sure that the both gears are touching the lugs equally. So if this is not machined correctly, the one tooth will take more of the drive than the other tooth, and then that will break a pair of set of a pair of lugs off the pump really quick. So here is a set of our racing pump gears that are, I think the correct terminology is Teflon coated. If you feel these, they're really slippery. They're made from a hard metal, and when the pump gears first came out, man, I had a hard time with them eating pumps, because the hard metal was eating the soft body. So ever since these got Teflon coated, that problem has been gone. I've never had a problem. I also have another set of pump gears that are not Teflon coated, that are made from a softer material, that still have the thick lugs, and those work just as good too. I seem to be having problems getting inventory sometimes. So sometimes I might have these, sometimes I might have the other style that are not tin coated. They're both just as good. So you'll see on here that the lugs go flush with the face of the gear where it doesn't on a Chrysler. So it's real important that you put these in correctly. Unlike Chrysler pump gears, they'll go in both ways. These will fit both ways, but only is going to fit one way. You put them the other way, the converter is not going to go in all the way. So that's the wrong way. That is the correct way. And I usually put a little F on there for front. And so when you put them in there, you put them towards the front seal, like so. And you'll see that the racing pump gears have a lot less slop between acceleration and deacceleration. So these are a real nice piece. We got them on the website for 727s and 904s. So did I cover everything on the pump bodies and covers? I think I did. So even though Chrysler only made two different pump covers. For the 727, there are five different input shafts and five different pump stators. Your typical input shaft and hub looks like this. The piston goes in here. This goes in the torque converter. And each input shaft and hub has to have a matching stator. So I'm going to show you how to ID the stators without, and I'm going to do them in order. Here's it is. This one, and this one, and this one. So, because you got, you Chrysler guys may or may not know, from 1962 to 1966, the input shafts were 19 spline. And those was just this first spline that they came out with. So Chrysler's sealing rings on these are smaller than the 24 spline. So you could take, how am I going to do this? You can take a 24 spline stator and it will fit on a 19 spline input shaft, but it's going to be real loose and you're going to have no forward movement. So you have to make sure that if you're having a 19 spline, the best way to do it is test fit it like that. That's how I do it. So the first generation, I guess you can say, the first design is the 19 spline from 1962 to 1966. In 1967, Chrysler went to a 24 spline. Then they increased the size diameter of the sealing rings, thus the stator support tube is a different size. So that is the second generation. Here again, how could you tell the difference between the 67 and up and the 62 to 66? I don't have part numbers, I just have the shafts. You just got to make sure they fit. Both of these stators use the early direct drum or forward drum that takes the narrow bushing. As you can see, the narrow bushing that goes on the drum, but it rides on here in the pump. So that is the same on both of them. The sealing ring distance between the two is also the same. So those are the first 2 years. And the 19 spline is probably the most uncommon. The 67 and up to 70 is pretty common. But the one that is the most common that I probably use in all my performance transmissions is this stator. This is the 1971 to 1977 stator. In 71, they went from, in 70, the narrow bushing to the wide bushing. So how you can tell the difference between the two is the land. I hope this is focusing in. The land right here is wider, and then they move the two sealing ring lands closer together. So that's an obvious one, and you'll see that the wide bushing is the same thick or diameter as the land, and the narrow bushing you'll see is too much. So the only difference between the 62 to 70, the only difference between the 66 to 70 and the 71 and up is the land size. The tube diameter is the same. Then in 19, Chrysler changed the input shafts and stators again. And they had a non-lockup version and a lockup version. And as you can see, on all Chrysler lockup transmissions, it has this machined area right here. That's a dead giveaway by just looking at the front of the transmission if it's a lockup or not. So the lockup input shaft and the non-lockup in shaft are obviously different. And then in 78 and up. I misspoke. This is 1978 and up when they came out with the lockup. When doing that, they have two rings on the input shaft and then one ring on the hub. So you can call it three rings total, where the earlier 77 and earlier only had two rings on the input shaft and that was it. So they changed the stator to accommodate that. There's a ring land here and then two inside the stator. So how do you tell the difference between a non-lockup stator and a lockup stator? It's actually quite easy. But before I tell you that, all 62 to 77 pump stators have one hole and one ball. In 78, the non-lockup version had two balls and one hole. The two ball, one hole is 78 and up non-lockup. The 78 and up lockup had three balls, no holes. And that's how you tell the difference. You have to keep the stator support matched with your shaft. So if you have, let me go down here a little more. If you have the 78 lockup input shaft and up, you got to have the stator that has the three balls. That's a match set. If you have the 78 and up non-lockup, input shaft and hub, you need the one that's two balls, one hole. As far as servicing stator supports, you just want to put these in a lathe and polish them right here. Make sure that this surface is nice and flat. You can't run your nail across it. In the racing world, I don't know if I'm gonna have to get in a picture with this. We mill this out. You can only do that on reverse manual valve bodies and trans brakes. If you do that on an automatic shift or on a forward manual, you'll have band overlap really bad. So you can only do that on racing transmissions with manual valve bodies. The stator does have a serviceable bushing. You simply would just go from the inside and use a punch that's sharp to drive the old one out. Put the new one in. There's a little boss down in here, so you can't go too far. It'll stop you from going in any further. So what else do you need to know about the pumps? So hopefully I told you guys everything there is to know about these pumps and how to identify them. Rebuilding them is quite easy. Make sure that the pump gears are good. Always put a new bushing in there, stake it, and any of the parts, the racing pump gears, the anything that you need for the bushings or whatever, we got it. If you've never got one of our catalogs, go to our website and request one. I'll give you a free catalog. You also get one free with every order. All right, well, thanks again for coming to the channel. You can see all our product at CulpRacingTrans.com. You can contact us through the website. You can request a catalog. You can get one of these cool CRT t-shirts. And thanks for watching, guys, and Mopar to ya.